its areas of Rajasthan, that is Marufthali desert areas of Rajasthan, the areas of Kutch in Gujarat, or even some parts of Saurashtra, some parts of Saurashtra where irrigation systems are not there, some parts of Kutch in Gujarat and some parts of Marufthali, they would be part of dryland agriculture. The areas of Ladakh, the areas of Lahul Spiti, we have discussed those areas, they are also part of dryland agriculture. So the Ladakh region, Lahul and Spiti, which are the cold desert regions of India, they are part of dryland agriculture. We have all of these areas which are the most neglected agriculture regions in the country. These are areas which have seen government neglect since independence, even before that. And these are the areas where we have bulk of economic, ecological and social problems. These are the areas wherein we would have a very, very low productivity. The productivity is very low. And this is also the area where, because we don't have any irrigation systems, we would have a very low cropping intensity. So if you remember, we said that cropping intensity would depend on irrigation systems. If I have good irrigation system, I can cultivate the crop when we have the monsoon. I can cultivate the crop in the Rabi season as well. I can cultivate it in the Zaid season as well. So if I would have irrigation systems, the cropping system, the cropping intensity improves. But yahan par there is no irrigation system present, the farmer is cultivating the crop only during the time of monsoon. And if you remember, we have already said that all those areas wherein we would have less rainfall, these are also the areas where rainfall varies more. Variation of rainfall is more for those areas where we have less of rainfall. So very often the rainfall fails in this area. And because irrigation systems are not available, if the rainfall fails, then rainfall failure many times translates to crop failure. So we have problems of monsoon failure here, we have problems of crop failure here, we have problems of low cropping intensity, and many times in case of crop failure, it also leads to problems of farmer suicides. So maximum of the farmer suicides that we have in the country, they would be in the areas of dryland agriculture. These are also the areas where very often the farmers, they would leave their land fallow. I mean, I am cultivating the crop only once in a year. For rest of the 7-8 months, the land is idle. If I am cultivating crops, let's say crop fails, I am not able to cultivate it, I would move to the urban center to look for some new job, the land is idle. So rural out-migration is a problem in this area. Other than this, we have a problem where if I am leaving the land fallow, this fallow land would be prone to soil erosion. Because till the time you would have crops, till the time you would have any kind of vegetative matter on the soil is protected from erosion. The roots of the plant, they would hold the soil together. But because the land is fallow, the land is prone to erosion. And this is the area where we have problems of desertification. If I look at the problems of land degradation, the biggest problem that we have in the country is related to the desertification problem. Somewhere around 810 million hectares of land is at different levels of degradation, out of which 80 million hectares of land alone is at different levels of desertification. Almost 20-22% of the total land in Rajasthan, it is under desertification. We have somewhere around 12-14% of the total land in Jammu and Kashmir, in Gujarat and Maharashtra, which is at different levels of desertification. So desertification is a major problem here. So we have problems related to low agriculture production, low agriculture productivity. We have problems related to farmer suicide, rural out-migration, land soil erosion, land desertification. So a number of issues are there. But despite all of these problems, the areas of dryland agriculture, they contribute very significantly to the overall agriculture production in the country. If I look at the dry crops like pulses, dry crops like millet, oil seeds, most of these dry crops, they are produced in the areas of dryland agriculture. Where do we have bulk of groundnut produced? Groundnut is the most important oil seed. So dry areas of Gujarat, they would produce groundnut. Some dry areas of Maharashtra, they would produce groundnut. Where do we have bulk of millets like bajra? Bajra is largely cultivated in the dry areas of UP, or it is cultivated in the areas of Rajasthan where we have very little amount of rainfall. Ragi. Ragi again a very important millet. Ragi is limited to the dry areas of Uttarakhand. Ragi is limited to the dry areas of Karnataka. So we have ragi which is cultivated in these two areas. Or jowar. jo are largely cultivated in Maharashtra, the dry areas. So we would have these areas, though they have a number of issues, but they are contributing very significantly. 90% of the millets that are produced in the country, they are produced in the areas of dry and agriculture. And not only millets, or we have good amount of pulses, 75% of pulses, 75% of oilseeds produced in these areas. Because these are the crops that would require a little amount of rain or lesser amount of water. I mean, we have problems of malnourishment in the country. We have problems of people which are undernourished. We have problems where children have stunted growth. And one of the reasons is that the cultivation of nutri cereals has come down. If you remember, we had said that farmers in Marathwada who are cultivating groundnut, who are cultivating jowar, or who are cultivating tuvar dal, these are the farmers where only 3% of the land is irrigated. But farmers who are cultivating sugarcane in Maharashtra, 100% of the area is irrigated. What is the reason? The reason is, when you provide irrigation to the farmer switches to water intensive crop. Because sugarcane, maybe we have a very good margin, a margin of more than 80%, 75%. But in these areas of pulses, millets, and oil seeds, we have little margin, plus the government does not procure them directly. So these are the crops that would require a very little amount of water. They require very little amount of nutrient. They are very hardy crops. They are very resilient to the climate change. And they can provide all the nutrients that the body requires. Problems of anemia in the Indian women, it can be solved if I would cultivate more of the millets or nutri cereals. The zinc deficiency that we have in the people of the country, it can be solved if I am cultivating more of the millets. So I need to produce more of millets, pulses, oil seeds. And those are largely produced in the areas of dry and agriculture. So they have a number of problems, but they are significantly contributing. And if you want to solve the problems of malnutrition, if you want to solve the problems of hunger in the country forever, you would have to focus on the areas of dry and agriculture. So these are the areas where we have very high yield gap. If you remember, Maharashtra, mein tuvar dal ke liye yield gap was somewhere around 61%. So we have this as the area where yield gap is very, very high. So it is very easy to close down this yield gap, very easy to increase the production productivity just by making small changes here and there. So this is the area that has to be focus of the government's policies. We have to focus on these areas if we want to solve the problems of malnourishment, if we want to solve the problems of hunger in the country. And what can we do to solve the problems here? What can be the possible solutions to the areas of dry agriculture? The first idea is that you will have to provide water to the fields. I would have to arrange for irrigation system. But if I look at the total cultivable area in the country, there's a limitation of the irrigation system where I cannot provide the irrigation system to each and every area of the country. Each and every area of the country cannot be provided with irrigation system. Now, many of the areas, or almost all the areas of the country, they would have some systems of rainwater harvesting. And that is passed from one generation to another generation through the traditional knowledge. I need to harvest this rainwater, whatever is the amount of rainfall, even though we have less amount of rainfall here, every drop of water has to be conserved here. So we need to have traditional systems of rainwater harvesting in this region. In Maharashtra, we have some systems of water harvesting which are known as bandhara. You have heard about this. Bandhara is a drainage system wherein we would make check dams along the rivers. So I have a river. If this is the river valley, if I'm looking at the top view, let's say, this is the top view of a river. If this is the topic, what I am doing is, I am making some of the walls or check dams at regular intervals. I have a river where water flows. When the water flows in this river, water would erode the river valley. River valley would be eroded. When the river valley is eroded, then in that case, this eroded material would get deposited in the downstream region. And during the time of monsoon season, the carrying capacity of the river would reduce. We yahan se some soil gets eroded. I don't have this dam or I don't have this wall here. So water moves in this direction. Water moves very fast, it erodes the soil. Where will the eroded material go? It will go in the region of downstream regions. In the downstream regions, it gets deposited in the river valley. Again, this is my river valley. Some part of the river valley would now have the deposits. What about the carrying capacity of this river? Reduces. And the carrying capacity reduces, very easily river overflows. So this problem of soil erosion in the upstream regions, can I say that it can lead to problems of floods in the downstream regions? So I have this problem. Other than this, if I would have the water which is moving very, very fast, faster is the movement of water, lesser would be the percolation of water. So what I would do is, I would make some of the check dams here. I would make some of the walls here at regular intervals. Now, when water strikes this wall, when water would strike this wall, water would become stagnant. When the water becomes stagnant, good part of the water would seep to the ground level. It would recharge the groundwater. And the nearby areas of the river, they would now have a moist soil. And some of the crops, like millet, they can survive on the soil moisture itself. They don't require rainfall. Bajra can be cultivated on the base of soil moisture. If the soil has some amount of moisture, you can cultivate bajra there. So the groundwater is recharged, the soil is kept moist. Moreover, when the river water strikes this wall, the speed of the river water reduces. When the speed of this river water reduces, then we would have less of erosion. Less of erosion takes place. Again, I would have river entering into this part. Some water stagnates here, and again groundwater gets recharged. So Bandhara is a system where we are creating bunds along the river. That is, we are creating check dams along the rivers. So this is the traditional system of rainwater harvesting in the areas of Maharashtra. Systems of similar nature in Rajasthan, they are known as Johar. If you get time, read about the Arvari project. Arvari project carried out by Tarun Bharat Sangh. There was a river, Arvari River. Arvari River, it was a dry river. So earlier in the past 100 years, we had some amount of water in the Arvari River. But because of continuous deforestation, because of mining in those areas, the Arvari River, it had become extinct almost. So a project was taken under Rajendra Singh, and this project was known as Arvari River Project. It was under an organization known as Tarun Bharat Sangh. Now, number of trees were planted, number of johars were made, and after some time, Arvari River, it gained a new lease of life. And today, Arvari River is almost a perennial river in the area of Rajasthan. And it has turned the fortunes of the village in the nearby areas. So what we do in Johar, a similar system is there. That is, I have a river. Alongside the river, I would make some depression. So I would dig up this river valley. So I would make a depression here. I'm looking at the top view, I would make a depression. And I would make one check dam alongside this depression. Aise karke ek depression bana diya, uske alag, aage we would make a check dam. Again, I would make a depression. And again, I would make a check dam. Similar system to the system that we have in Bandhara. So some water accumulates here in the river valley. Some water, as it accumulates, it would move down, it would percolate into the soil, recharge the groundwater, and make the nearby soil moist. So we have this as a system that has to be practiced. If you know that there is a district in the regions of Maharashtra, Jalna. Jalna is an area which is a very dry region. Jalna is a village known as Kadwanchi village. Now this Kadwanchi village, it was witnessing drought since the last 20 years. But farmers in those areas, through the community labor, they have started making farm ponds there. That is, alongside the field, I have this as a village, or this is a large area. What I would do is, I would make a slope towards the center, a very gentle slope of it, from this side towards the center, from this side towards the center. So I would make this area, I would have a very gentle slope in this area. And in this area, the idea is whatever rainfall takes place in this area, I have this as a catchment area. That is, rainfall moves towards the center because slope is towards the center. At the center, I would have a depression. At the center, I would have a depression. Whatever rainfall takes place, this rainfall gets collected here. Yahan par, I would plant a number of trees. number of trees are planted because the trees, they would hold the soil together, they would prevent erosion. So that soil erosion is prevented at a very gentle slope and the water enters and water accumulates here. This is known as pond or a tank. A pond can be constructed alongside a feed district. That is known as a farm pond. So whatever water enters into the farm, it enters into that pond. So many such initiatives were taken in that village, and since the past 20 years, this village was witnessing droughts. Now this is a village which does not witness droughts, and this is the village which would have very high productivity for grapes. It started cultivating grapes. Grapes are a very important fruit in many areas of Maharashtra. So this is an area that started cultivating grapes, and we have a good productivity here. The income of the farmer has increased by almost 3 times in this area in the past 20-30 years when we have started constructing these kind of farm ponds. So we have a lot of the water that can be trapped. Every area would have its own system. As a system of the Gujarat mein. Gujarat mein this is covered. And this is known as Tanka in Gujarat. So we have systems of underground ponds or underground tanks which are covered that are known as Tankas in Gujarat. So Johars in Rajasthan, Tankas in Gujarat, Bandharas in Maharashtra, farm ponds. So all of these are the systems. Or if you remember, when we discussed about the regions of Ladakh and Lahul Spiti, we said that these are the areas where rainfall is very less. These are the areas where the cultivation season is short. Do you remember we said that farmers, they would cultivate the crop by using the meltwater of snow? Yes, sir. It said meltwater of snow is diverted to the agriculture land flow system, which is known as? If you remember, we said that we have zincs in Ladakh, pools in Madhya Pradesh. Repeating it, if I am not done, I will tell you again that this is the area, Ladakh region, or Lahul Spiti in Himachal. These are the areas which are very, very dry. These are the cold deserts of the country. Yahan par cultivation season is very short because for good part of the year the area is covered under. What the farmers could do is that during the time of monsoon season, some amount of snow starts melting. When the snow starts melting, the melt water of snow, it is collected and it is diverted in channels to the agriculture. These channels are constructed and maintained by the community labor, and it is known as zincs in Ladakh. In Jammu and Kashmir, it is known as zinc. And in Lahul Spiti, in Himachal, they are known as kul. So these are also systems of rainwater harvesting. So almost all the areas of the country, whether it would have high rainfall or it would have low rainfall, they would have certain traditional systems of water harvesting. So I need to focus on rainwater harvesting. Every drop of water has to be collected. We need to provide irrigation as well. See, I can conserve the water. I have to go for traditional systems of rainwater harvesting. But we also need to provide certain systems of irrigation which the government can provide. Now, what is the system of irrigation that you're trying to introduce into this area? The canal system of irrigation, it is not the most preferred system of irrigation. We have discussed about the problems related to low water use efficiency canal. The water use efficiency is as low as 38%. We are losing water during storage, during transportation, during application. Moreover, canal is a system which is very, very costly to construct and even costlier to maintain. It takes a lot of money to construct a canal and it takes more amount of money to maintain this canal. I have this as a canal, the vertical cross section. If a canal is taking, let's say, 100 crores for the construction, then every year the canal would require 50 crores for its annual maintenance. Canal draws water from the river. During the monsoon, river carries a lot of muddy water, carries a lot of sand and silt along with it. When the river water is diverted to canal, the sandy water or the water that has a lot of mud and silt in it, it also enters into the canal. Canal may route have the barrages. If canal is going, I want to divert water towards this side. I want to divert water towards this side, so I would make a gate. If a gate is placed in the canal, what would happen to the speed of the water? reduces, when the speed reduces, what would happen to the sand and silt? It settles down. So some part of the canal, it would have the sand and silt. Let's say earlier, the carrying capacity of canal was 100 meter cube of water per second. Now with some part of the canal occupied by sand and silt, carrying capacity reduces to, let's say, 60 meter cube of water per second. Itna carrying capacity would have. So every canal in the country is running under capacity. So if you want to take out this sand and silt every year after monsoon season, dredging operations are conducted. That is, you would take out the sand and silt. And these dredging operations are very, very costly. And these dredging operations, they are very much prone to corruption. So canal irrigation, it would have a very high cost of construction, very high cost of maintenance as well. Other than this, what about the gestation period of canal? That is, a canal system, it would take a lot of time before it can be actually used by the farmers. Then first the government would have to look at a site where I can make a reservoir. Then the people would be displaced, I would have the land acquisition that would be done. After this, I would have cost overruns. After this, I would have time overruns. And then we would have the land which would be acquired for constructing a canal. Canal would be constructed, it would take a lot of time. And then after 10 to 12 years, the people would get the water. So canal irrigation, it has a very long gestation period. There was a project that was to be inaugurated in Bihar last year. This project, it took 44 years to complete. And on the day when the minister was to inaugurate this, the dam, it broke down. So this was in Bihar last year. So we have a very long gestation period in the canal irrigation. So problems are related to the high cost of construction, high cost of maintenance, and long gestation period. Other than this, there are problems related to the distribution of water. So distribution of water is a problem in case of canal irrigation. If this is the canal, this is the head of the canal. This is the tail of the canal. I have some fields here, towards the head, some fields towards the tail. We are saying that we have problems related to water distribution in the canal. The water starts entering from the head and it has to move towards the tail. In most parts of North India, this is the area where we largely have the perennial rivers. So North India would have largely the canal system. In Peninsular India, rivers are seasonal, so they would not have the canals. You have a North India system that is used, which is known as Barabandi system. That is, turn-wise, you would get the water from the feet. So under Barabandi system, the ideal situation is that water starts from this area head and water enters first to tail. And as the water enters to this tail, then the field 1 and 2, they are to first use the water. They would make a cut and then they would draw the water. Then the field 3 and 4, they would draw the water. Then is the turn of 5 and 6, then is the turn of 7 and 8. So system is this, where I would have the fields which are towards the tail end of the canal, they have to use the water first. But what happens is opposite. That is, the fields which are towards the head of the canal, they would make the first cut. And by the time we reach towards field number 1 and 2, now the canal is dry. We don't have any water with the canal. So distribution problems are there with the canal. Other than the distribution problems with the canal, canal irrigation is the most centralized system of irrigation. That is, if I need water, I am not the person who is going to decide when to release the water, when not to release the water. I would need a decentralized system which is totally under my control. Why is a tube well so popular? Because tube well may, when to use the water, when not to use the water, it totally depends on discretion of the farmer. Whenever he wants to use water, he would just switch on the motor and the water comes out. But that is not the case with canal. In most of the area, the government would decide the turn that this farmer will get water on this and this day, between this and this time period. This farmer would get water on this and this day. So it is a most centralized system of irrigation where farmers would have a little control over the canal water. So we are not encouraging this canal irrigation system in this area. long gestation period, high cost of construction, higher cost of maintenance, plus it is a system which would have a very, very low efficiency. Pluvials cannot be taken up because many of the dry areas, they don't have groundwater. The presence of groundwater, to a large extent, it would depend on the amount of rainfall. It would depend on the soil, whether soil is permeable or not, or it would depend on rainfall. Areas where we have high rainfall, they would have a shallow level of groundwater. Areas with a low rainfall, they would have a deeper level of groundwater. So many of these areas, dryland agriculture regions, they don't have enough of groundwater. So groundwater cannot be used. So we are focused on the systems of rainwater harvesting, and using the small amount of water that we have saved, we can irrigate the fields, but with a better technology. In the long run, the government says, if the resources permit, we have to introduce the drip irrigation systems in these areas. Drip irrigation systems not only would have very high efficiency, but drip irrigation, they would solve a number of problems that are otherwise associated with the cultivation of crops. Let's say I have a farm pond. I have a farm pond where I can save some amount of water. From this farm pond, I would have some of the pipes that would run. Then there would be a pump. And from the pump, a number of pipes would start. I have, let's say, this as my field. This is my field. After I plow the field, what I would do is, I would lay down small pipes, thin pipes, either over the surface or slightly under the surface. So at the surface or at the subsurface level, I would lay down these small pipes. So these thin pipes, they would draw water from the pump. So pump say, it would get the water. When I want to cultivate the crops, I would sow the seeds along the rows where the pipes are there. So when I would plow the field, after plowing the field, I would lay down the pipeline network in the field. And each of these pipelines, they would have some openings. Yahan par ek opening hui from where the water comes from. At the opening, I would attach a device. The device that is attached at the opening, it is known as emitter. So yahan par I would attach a device which would be known as emitter. The job of the emitter is to release the water drop by drop. Drop by drop, water comes out. And the frequency of water release, it would depend on the crop that I'm cultivating. Like a farmer who is cultivating oil palm requires a lot of water, so the frequency would be higher. Farmer who is cultivating coconut, frequency would be slightly lesser. If I'm cultivating dry crop, then water would come out after a lot of time. So water would come out from this emitter drop by drop. Again, another opening, one more emitter is attached. So I would have the emitters that would be attached to the pipelines. When I'm sowing seeds, I'm sowing seeds at the places along these rows. So those rows where I would have the pipelines, I would sow the seeds here. So yahan par I would sow the seeds. I would sow the seeds here. This drip irrigation system, it would solve the number of problems. First problem it would solve is that it would save the water. The efficiency of drip irrigation system, it is somewhere around 90%. That means 90% of the water that is meant for the plant, it is actually utilized by the plants. Limited amount of the evaporative losses, limited amount of seepage losses, because water falls very, very slowly and water falls drop by drop directly at the root of the plant. Second, when we discussed about the flood irrigation technique, we said that flood irrigation technique is wasteful because it loses a lot of water. Moreover, flood irrigation technique leads to problem of soil erosion. Remember? Yahan par, when the water is falling drop by drop at the root of the plant, will I have erosion? I would not have erosion here. So because I would have water falling somewhere here drop by drop, I would not have any amount of erosion. So it would solve the problem of soil erosion. Second, it is a system where fertilizer can also be used very, very efficiently. If you remember, we have said that the usage of fertilizer would largely depend on the irrigation systems. All those areas where we would have systems of irrigation are the areas where good amount of fertilizer is used. 98% of arable land in Punjab is irrigated, 248 kgs per hectare is a used urea fertilizers. So what can we do is that if I have a source where some water is stored, yahan par I would dissolve some fertilizers. The fertilizer would be dissolved. After dissolving the fertilizers, when the pump takes up this water and water comes out from this emitter, with every drop of water that is coming out, that is reaching to the plant, then every drop would also have some amount of nutrients. Nutrients would also be there. This system, when fertilizers are applied along with irrigation, is known as fertigation. Fertigation means fertilizers along with irrigation. So this is a system, drip irrigation, where application of fertilizer becomes easy and also fertilizer use efficiency also improves. So this is a system where I would save a lot of fertilizers, I would save a lot of water, and I would prevent the soil erosion. Other than this, this is a system that can also solve the problem of weeds. We discussed about the unwanted plants, unwanted grasses. Unwanted grasses, they would come to my field, and unwanted grasses, they would utilize the nutrients that are meant for my crops. They would utilize the water that's meant for my crops. When we discussed about this weed, we had said that weeds would come into this stage, let's say X, in this stage Y. Because when I'm going for flood irrigation, whole of the area gets water, whole of the area gets fertilizer. So in between the rows of my plants, I would have the weeds. But is this area X or is this area Y getting any amount of water or nutrients now? Now the nutrients are falling directly at the root of the plant, and every part of that nutrient, every part of that water is utilized. So water would be given to the plants, but the areas in between the different rows, they would remain dry. And because these areas are dry, I would not have the problem of weeds here. So automatically the problem of weeds can be solved. So this is a system that is very, very efficient. Moreover, many areas of the world which are having dry conditions, like Israel, or for example California and USA, these are the areas where soil salinization is a problem. But these are the areas wherein, after using the drip irrigation systems, the salinization problem has been controlled to a very large extent. To a very large extent, salinization problem has been solved in these areas. So this drip irrigation system, though it is costly, but it has a lot of benefits. So government, in the long run, it has to introduce the drip irrigation systems in the areas of direct agriculture. So first part of the solution is that I would have to provide water to the fields, I would have to arrange for the traditional systems of water harvesting, and if the resources are there, we have to go for this drip irrigation system. That would solve problems of salinization, soil erosion, weeding, and it would make the use of the fertilizer more efficient. Yahan tak samajh aaya? Abhi likhiye itna, then we'll discuss some other things. What is dryland agriculture? Question mark. Discuss the importance of dryland agriculture. Discuss the importance of dryland agriculture. Next question. What is dryland agriculture? Question mark. Discuss the importance of dryland agriculture in augmenting food supply in India. Discuss the importance of dryland agriculture in augmenting food supply in India. And the first part of both the questions is the same.
Yes.
That is what is dryland agriculture. Are we able to pick up the difference between the two questions in the second part?
Yes, sir.
In the first question, you have to write about the ecological importance, the the economic importance and the social importance. The first is highlight what are the problems and how these problems can be solved if we address the issues of brand agriculture. In the second question, the question is only talking about the augmentation of food supply. So the question, when you start writing this answer, first you begin by the problem statement. That is, we have a number of problems in the country related to the import of oil seeds, related to the import of pulses, related to malnutrition, related to the problems of anemia in the country. And we have these problems because the area under nutri cereals is lesser. Area under oil seeds, area under pulses is lesser. So the dryland agriculture regions, these are the areas where maximum of the pulses, millets and oil seeds are cultivated. So if these areas, they are taken into consideration, if we are able to address the problems of these areas, most of our problems related to hunger, most of problems related to food security, they can be solved. Moreover, you also include the concept of yield gap here. Here, the yield gap is very, very high. So small and a marginal improvement can bridge down the yield gap, and as a result, we would have a better production. The food supply of the country can be augmented. You also highlight the problems related to the cropping intensity, how the land in the country is likely to shrink in the near future, and how there is a greater demand for optimizing productivity and cropping intensity. And these are the areas where yield gap is very, very high. The concept of yield gap, so you have to mention all of this. Try attempting this question. And note it down. And what is that making? Areas where rainfall is less than 75 centimeters and where the farmers practice agriculture without irrigation, are dryland agriculture regions. It is the most neglected area in the country. Where we have problems related to, poverty, malnutrition, rural out-migration, farmer suicides, etc. As the farmer leaves the land fallow, within brackets, low cropping intensity, the land is prone to soil erosion. We have problems of desertification. Soil salinization, where land is becoming infertile, Next paragraph. But despite all these problems, the areas contribute very significantly contribute very significantly to the overall agriculture production. With bulk of millets, pulses, and oil seeds, produced in these areas. The areas also have a very high yield gap. Which means that it has a lot of potential for increase in productivity. Most of our problems related to malnutrition, hunger, and undernourishment can be solved if we are able to solve the problems of the dryland agricultural regions. So we'll continue this topic in the next lecture. Thank you very much.
चप्पल यहाँ से